Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this rundown for global stocks and commodities for the 15th of July. We've had very, very choppy conditions since the end of that real blow-off top that we got in at the end of January. So the last five and a bit months have been extremely erratic. They've been very much driven by news headlines, and I think that's probably going to continue. But as I pointed out last week, within that fluctuation that we're seeing, which is fairly substantial, and it's fairly off-putting for most people. What we have seen is a continuation of an upward trend in all the indices in America, and even recently the Australian ASX 200 has been joining in that as well. But I think it's safe to assume, as your basic assumption, that choppy markets are going to continue for the foreseeable future, and possibly for for quite a few years until we reach a more meaningful correction. So let's jump in and take a look at what I'm going to cover in this edition. The economic fundamental conditions for the US economy and also for the US corporate world continues to be, not too hot, not too cold. It's about right. There is no real excesses being built up. Stock prices are going up basically on earnings. Valuations aren't a problem, despite what you might hear and read from those that would like it to be otherwise. So really the fundamental backdrop for share prices to continue to go up is pretty good. How are the stocks likely to respond? Well, I'll dust off my crystal ball and see what we can determine. But as always, I think if you've been watching these videos for any length of time, you know that my approach is just to play the ball as it comes down the pitch. Don't try and predict. Don't try and second guess what the market's going to do. And take a position, just play it as it comes, go with what is, and at the moment, the market bias is still to the upside. There'll be the normal stock and commodity trend update, of course, covering precious metals and oil and other commodities. And in portfolio analysts last week, there were a couple of the members put forward some highly promising Australian technology stocks that I think have got potentially absolutely enormous upside. So that was pretty exciting to analyse those two. They were two stocks that I had not come across before. So it was a pleasure to go through and do the analysis on those stocks. Now the US index, the S&P was up by 0.6% for the week. That was on top of 1.5% last week. And I did note in last week's weekend update that sentiment was encouragingly bearish. And I took that to be a good contrarian opportunity in the market. And so it turned out to be. Prices went up. So, you don't want to be buying into the market when sentiment is good. So if you're sitting back waiting for things to feel comfortable, then you're too late. In fact, you're almost at the top of the market. And I think that's a concept that you need to embrace from here on in, perhaps, forever. Well, not forever, that's a bit strong, but you know what I mean. I think if you try and do things when it feels right, it's going to be way too late. You're going to have to be very clear about your game plan and have the confidence to execute it where nobody else really wants to. And that's how you're going to make money in this market. The index is right at key resistance now. It's at that 2800 point level, which is an overhead resistance, as we'll see, but it's also the top of the boundary of the rising channel as well. So it's a couple of reasons why we might get a bit of a pullback in the market in the short term. The 2017 uptrend remains in play. I've been showing this all year, and nothing has changed there. So I think it's safe to expect more choppy, erratic trading that'll be driven by what Trump says or does, by headlines, by computer algorithms reacting. It's impossible to try and play that game. You've got to play a different game. The focus now will switch to earnings season, which started on Friday with reports from JP Morgan, Wells Fargo, and Citigroup. Two exceeded expectations. One was basically in line with expectations. And so it was a fairly benign start to earnings season, but there's the expectations are for pretty good growth in earnings of the order of 20% for this quarter. Now the US dollar was a little bit higher for the week, but really it's just building momentum underneath the resistance level. So I wouldn't be surprised to see ultimately the US dollar do a sudden breakout to the upside. So let's jump in and take a look at the charts for the US market. So this is the S&P on a daily. You can see this dotted line here is basically the midpoint of the uptrend through 2017, which was very stable. In fact, we might even be able to just sort of move that one down slightly. Just get it to go. That's probably a better reflection. So you can see that 2017, it was a great uptrend. The fluctuations above and below that trend were very small, only a few percent. We then got a major blow-off in January, which then signaled this very choppy conditions that we've had. And you can see that whilst in the last few months we've remained below that trend line, the actual trend itself is still in line with the former trend in 2017. So I know that it doesn't feel like it. It feels ugly. And if you take it from the top that we had in January, then you know we're still below that January high. But really, when you look at it, all that's happened here is that the fluctuations have just got a lot wider. And that's made it extremely difficult to trade for most people. If you're a long-term holder, then, and you're pretty resilient to these sort of fluctuations, then it's probably not that big an issue. But the vast majority of people aren't really equipped mentally to deal with this sort of fluctuation because you never know where it's going to go. You know, you don't know whether this breakdown here is going to lead to a much more significant breakdown that might have the indices down around here somewhere. So most people will be forced to move their exposure around and try and play this market a little bit more tactically. So that's the S&P. As you can see, we're just tucked up here under this 2800. Resistance level, which is the peak from March, and we're also at the top of this trend channel. So we've got a trend channel here that has been running since really the March lows. We're to the top of that boundary as well. We haven't explored the lower reaches of this trend channel in recent months, but I wouldn't rule out that possibility. So now is not really the time to be increasing your exposure on the expectation that we get a breakout. It's possible we could get a little false breakout, but we're overbought now and this market has just been fluctuating between overbought and oversold, not really spending too much time at either extreme. So I don't think now's the time to be loading up, thinking that the market is looking better and it's going to break out. I would be looking for a pullback, more of a panic selling day. So the day when most people don't want to buy, that's when you want to be thinking about buying. Now the NASDAQ also just continues to power on. Yes, the FANG stocks are doing brilliantly well. Amazon's up around $1,800. Google's $1,200. So you know they're continuing to march on. But it's not just the FANG stocks. The breadth in small caps and the breadth in technology in particular is still very strong. So this is a very broad-based rally. So new highs in the NASDAQ. And if we look at the Russell small caps, didn't do quite as well. So a little bit easier during last week. So that's interesting. It would be insightful to see whether that continues as a trend, but look still well above the January highs, so you'd have to say small caps still doing pretty well. Now let's just look at the US dollar. So we've had a big run up. We've got resistance here, just a tick above 95. We're getting a consolidation around that level, which is normal. But I think the odds would be we're also getting higher lows here, and we're also getting higher highs as well. So we've actually got an upsloping channel there as well. So I wouldn't be surprised to see the US dollar break out, which should push all the other currencies down. And if you're an Australian investor with money in US stocks, then you're getting a boost there as well. Okay, that's the American scene. Now, there's a lot written about valuations, has been for a decade or more. And the people that want to make their case pull out all sorts of statistics to show that the US market is overvalued. But this is the reality. This is the forward PE ratio, and I believe this is the one that should be used, because stock prices are always on the basis of how the market sees things in 6, 9, 12 months' time. So if stock prices are framed by the market on the basis of the next 6 to 12 months, then why would you look at a PE ratio which is based on a trailing earnings? It just doesn't make any logical sense to me. So this is the forward-looking PE ratio for 2018. So this is where it's expected to be at the end of this year. And you can see that where we are right now is at 16 times, which is right bang on the 25-year long-term average. It's right in the middle of long-term average territory. So how anyone can say that the US market is grossly overvalued is just not dealing with the facts. So we've got a decent US economy. You know, it's not fabulous, and yes, there's a lot of debt, but look, no one knows how that's going to play out. So, you know, why worry about, people have been worrying about the US debt now for more than two decades. You know, why start worrying about it? The signs will be there when we need to do something about it and get out of the way. You know, don't worry about it in advance. Similarly, there's a lot of angst and hand-wringing going on over the fact that the 2-year, 10-year bond yield spread is getting down towards what's called inversion. And yes, if inversion does occur, then that generally leads to a major top in the stock market. But we're in exactly the same position. And I showed a chart of this to members on the weekend. We're in exactly the same position on that yield curve as we were in 1995. Now, 1995, it took 3 years before it actually inverted, and then it took another 2 years before we got recession and a top in the stock market. So that took 5 years. So to be worried about the yield curve inversion at this point in time is just plain stupid. So, you know, just ignore that and get on with the opportunities in front of you. That's my little rant for the day. There's just so much noise out there. And one of the reasons that I do this weekend video is to try and provide a helpful perspective so that traders and investors can negotiate their way through all the noise that's out there. You know, most of the opinion is coming from people with vested interests to push a certain line of thinking. And you've got to try and cut through all that. The Aussie dollar was flat across the week, but it did fluctuate around a fair bit between the low 73s and the mid 74s, but ended up at 74.3. The ASX index was pretty much flat, fell by a couple of points. The major winners were the healthcare sector, particularly Cochlear, CSL, ResMed, the majors. So that was the big winner for the week. But look, there's plenty of good movers outside the top 100. I've been focused pretty much only on those for more than a decade. And there are some great results happening at the moment, particularly in technology-type stocks in Australia. So some great opportunities have been unfolding there. Let's just look at the ASX 200 for the record. So you can see it was up, then it was down, and then it recovered, but net really didn't do very much. And similarly, with the Australian dollar, fluctuations above and below that that 74.3 level. Precious metals, gold was down another $14. So that's really reflecting a couple of things. It's reflecting the fact that long-term interest rates are moving up, which makes it less attractive for gold. It's also reflecting the fact that there's not as much fear around now about all sorts of things. Fear about China, fear about Trump, fear about North Korea. So gold has really been taking it on the chin, and also, of course, the US dollar is not helping. So gold price, as we'll see, has completely lost the upward trend channel, and I think $1,200 now looks more likely than not. And, you know, who would have thought just a few short weeks ago we were talking about a possible break of 1380, and now we're really looking at 1200. And I've made mention of this before, that precious metal stocks in particular will tend to lead the value of the precious metal itself. And I'd been pointing to the fact that GDX was not foreshadowing a rise and a breakout in the gold price, and that had been bothering me all year. In fact, for going back well back into 2017. And so ultimately, the rise in the gold price without stocks following always looked a bit suspicious to me. And that's really the way that it's playing out now. So let's take a look at gold. So there is gold on a daily chart. You can see we might have some short-term support here, but we've already had one little bounce. It was a pretty weak bounce. Didn't go very far. There were no really big candles, and we're back down there again. I would think it's more likely than not that this level is going to break, and then we're going to be down here around the 1200 mark. So I think more pressure for gold. The Australian gold producers have done well, but nothing else is. And there's the gold price. There's the clear break of that trend channel. We've been underneath it now for 3 weeks in succession, so that's not looking not a good outlook for gold at all. Other commodities, copper eased a few more cents to 282, and all of the base metals, nickel, zinc, lead, they're all looking decidedly weaker. Crude oil also has been very erratic of late, with all sorts of geopolitics going on. So back to 71, but at least it's still above that 70 breakout level. Energy stocks, however, just don't seem to be doing much at all. They're just, when the oil price went back down to 65, they didn't really sell off. When it went up to 75, they didn't really gain. They've just been sitting there, pretty much ignoring the fluctuations. That's at the index level, but I do note that the biggest and the better of the energy stocks like ConocoPhillips, Anadarko Petroleum, those sort of stocks just keep getting better and better. So you've got to look under the hood with a lot of these sectors, because there's a tremendous amount of variability in the results. Let's just take a look at XLE. So this is the overall energy index, which includes your upstream refiners, your oil service companies, and also your exploration and production companies. So you can see we haven't had a lot of movement here over the last couple of months. So there's the spot copper chart. Really has been quite a smashing from $3.30 at the start of, or the middle of June, so only 4 weeks ago. There's been a lot of damage done in copper, and the other base metals look very similar. There's the crude oil chart. So there's been quite a bit of fluctuation between 65 and 74, and we're currently just in the top half of that range. So to wrap it all up, if you're a long-term holder, as I said earlier, you've just got to find a way to ignore the noise. So, you know, if you're resilient to the fluctuations, you don't look at the market regularly. You might only look at the market, you know, once a month or something of that nature, then I think you can try and ignore the noise. Make sure you're in good quality stocks. Make sure you're in stocks that are that have been in uptrend, and you're probably going to be okay. But that is the absolute minority. Nearly everyone else is going to need to pay attention to tactics, I believe. buying and taking profit, playing the ranges at the extremes. So buying during a sell-off, taking some partial profit when the price goes up to a resistance level. And because, you know, we haven't had a lot of breakouts in recent months. We've got a lot of volatile range trading happening. So the only way to make progress is to try and be a bit more active than normal. I think strong stocks are just going to keep getting stronger because of, you know, the behavior of institutions that have to outperform every quarter. So they're going to tend to focus on the stocks that are the strongest. And portfolio analyst this week, I've got some more good setups. Just really need a bit of a pullback in the market, and I think that's pretty likely. There's my contact details for any non-members. The free trial into Portfolio Analyst is also, of course, still available, and I'll be back with you next weekend. Cheers.